I commend it to the House.
I call Reno Tirikata.
Tēnā koe, Mr Speaker. Tēnā koe te kōtā te arepa. Tēnā tātou te whare. This is my first speech in the 52nd Parliament, sir, and so I wanted to, as is customary, congratulate you on your appointment and your fellow presiding officers for your appointments, and look forward to participating in the work of this 52nd Parliament. Can I also offer my congratulations to all returning members and new members? And I think from what I've observed, I've really enjoyed this debate thus far, sir, because we've heard from some outstanding contributions from new members on all sides, but in particular Dr. Duncan Webb, Liz Craig, Priyanka. It's yeah, I'm very proud to be standing on this side of the House and amongst such such really capable colleagues. And sir, I've got lots to say about this bill, but in fact, I was very had the honour of giving a speech at rather short notice on the second reading of this bill, sir. And I had a quick glance over the Hansard, and yeah, it's never a good idea. Yes, I thought back in hindsight. I was able to weave contributions from Jono Naylor, who was a great member of this of the last Parliament, and his exploits with his reggae band, with a potential tort in Jamaica, and harm that Jamaicans may have been inflicted by some cultural misappropriation from such a performance. So. Yeah, I was stretching things. But, sir, I think that is exactly what tort is all about. It's about it's judge-made law that has been created by the doctrines and the pronouncements that have come through through the courts that we have inherited here also in Aotearoa. And inevitably, sir, there are disputes that arise when actions are committed across jurisdictions. And I guess in its most simplest form, that's what this bill is seeking to correct or simplify by ensuring that archaic rules such as double actionability have been abolished. And on that note, so I do want to acknowledge the sponsors of this bill. I thought this bill was a bit of a step beyond David Bennett when it was first introduced into the House. And now we know, sir, because I do acknowledge Sarah Dowie, the local member there in Invercargill, who has ably taken on this bill right to its third reading. It was revealed to us earlier in the debate, sir, that none other than the Honourable Christopher Finlayson was indeed the true legal brains behind this bill, and here we are at its third reading. I do acknowledge and respect the legal skills, I guess the legal mind of a eminent parliamentarian and jurist and practitioner such as Mr. Finlayson, but I must say, sir. We have Dr. Duncan Webb, and I must say that he can match Mr. Finlayson toe to toe on any discussions or debate around legal matters. And I really enjoyed the contributions from both, sir, because I could sense the legal whizzing of like two tops spinning in terms of their contribution around knowledge of the law and the knowledge of torts like. What was it? Entrapment? No, enticement, and other interesting torts that have been established by the courts. So much so, sir, I can just imagine the chargeable hours that would have been racked up by such legal minds, whirring as they were, in consideration and analysis of this bill. So, sir, that is one aspect of this bill which I'm sure will be welcomed by the legal community. The fact that there's always something to explain to clients and to add into any advice that they give. But I'd also, one aspect I think in the bill that is contained, which I think is, it overrides everything, and it is provided in the bill, sir, is the fact that clients can put it in writing. And once it's in writing, there's a contract, it's an agreement, and so it is conceivable that two parties or more can, in fact, anticipate that there may be a tortious claim that one or other may have in the future, and they can actually stipulate within the contract itself how they will deal with it and what applicable law will apply. And so, sir, I guess any decent lawyer, I guess, would always instruct their clients to put it in writing. And I guess that's the key aspect from this. When tortious claims and actions that are conducted is where there is harm that's been caused, where there hasn't been an agreement between parties, it's civil wrongs that have been committed from one party to another. And hence, that's why we need, that's why we are bringing clarity to the situation where a tortious act is committed in an overseas jurisdiction, and where between New Zealand's jurisdiction and somewhere else, wherever that act has been committed. Now, sir, I did mention in my last contribution on this bill some examples of what might be included within the ambit. Now, sure, I think the Jamaican reggae example might have been a stretch too far, I think we can just look around the house and look at recent legal action that's taking place, and sure, you know, adjusting some of the facts, you might be able to create a tort in maybe some of them. Just by way of example, I think Mr. Woods gave the example of Eminem, and maybe he could be claiming that there was a tortious wrong that was that he feels aggrieved in such a way that there was a tort committed by stealing and using his intellectual property or his music to promote election broadcast. I think in my last speech, sir, I also used the example of the tort of privacy or invasion of privacy, and we've heard about certain cases around surveillance or eavesdropping in on people, staff members, and you know, I guess the aggrieved party may, if they have a good lawyer, they may think they might be able to extend it to some sort of civil action as well, which might create a tortious action. Likewise, sir, case in point, we have the Right Honourable Winston Peters taking a privacy action against members opposite for...
Order. The member needs to come back to the bill.
Oh, sir, I'm very much addressing the bill because I'm talking about potential tortious actions. And so I'm just giving those as an example, sir, of if, for instance, one party is in another jurisdiction and then it comes to the point which law applies, then we are now enacting legislation, sir, which simplifies this area, simplifies those what would be vexed legal issues by making it very clear that in general, the place of wrongdoing rule will apply through the abolishment of the double actionability rule. So, sir, I commend this bill to the House. I think there's a lot that we can learn from it, and I'm sure that it will be of benefit to disputing parties in the future. Kia ora tātou.
I call Chris Penk.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.